All right, y'all, we're going to get started. Josiah. All right, first off, how you guys doing today? Good. My man paying attention. He locked in. You think you already told me, you said indifferent?
Indifferent.
Why?
You want me to keep it a bean with you or you need to just keep it subtle?
I mean, keep it a bean with me.
I ain't doing good right now, man.
Well, I mean, can you do me a favor real quick? Like, try to smile at me real quick. Yeah. All right, so you're here. It's just things can be better.
Yo, things can
definitely
be better.
Absolutely. I got you. My guy, Vern. Doing good?
This morning. Well, not really morning, but I'll say, yeah. Afternoon. Mm-hmm. Get up and just decide to come here.
Mm-hmm. What's your name, by the way, bro?
Bernard.
Nice to meet you, Bernard Brian. Josiah, how you feeling? How you feeling today?
Doing very well.
Doing very well? My man. I don't know if I got your name. Jendai.
There you go.
My man. Jendai. Oh my God, how you doing today? Isaiah, nice to meet you, Isaiah. Okay.
I'm just here. I'm just coming back. I've been off for a little bit, so I'm just feeling my way around.
I got you.
I welcome you to the cause. I never met you before.
Oh yeah, nice to meet you, Isaiah.
Your name is again?
Brian.
Brian.
Yep.
Right there.
Yep. Okay. Yep. Okay. What's your name, brother? Right behind me. What's your name, bro?
Josiah.
No. Oh, his name is Josiah, too?
His name is Josiah.
Josiah Jendai. I'm probably one. Jendai. How you feeling today, Josiah?
Doing good.
Doing good? Nice to meet you, bro. Were you, like, how many of you guys was here last week?
I was.
You was here. You was here?
Yeah, I came a little later.
All right. Josiah, you were here.
Yeah, I'm not
sure. All right. So, just want to recap a little bit. Well, actually, I'll let y'all sign in.
Yo, which one of the intros, man, or like, what's your name, bro? One more time.
Vern.
If you need videos, bro, I got you. Not videos. Music drums. Instrumental. Background drums.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah,
I remember
he's the beat guy. Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna start recording my own stuff. Oh yeah, I'm recording. That was gonna say. Mm-hmm. No, were you here last week? No? Oh, well. Do my best to catch you up. All
right.
Yeah,
I gotta bring that shit.
Hey, George.
That was a senior journal.
What's up?
For the summer program.
Stay in your lane.
Stay in your lane.
Yep. I still got a joke, too. He did it, man.
Stay in his lane.
No, that's the name of the John. At least I think that's what I told Al. So I think that's what how he... Hey.
Man, this is laughing me too tall, bro. I heard my leg with the middle. Gotta stretch them out.
I was gonna say, where y'all going, bro?
We'll be right back, okay? You better get started.
That's what I'm saying. I'm like, I just waited for y'all to sign in. That was the whole point. Alright.
You're a teacher now, so you gotta do it.
This guy, work with what we got. Alright. Alright, so this is the quote that I had last week. If you're not intentional about the life you want to live, you're going to end up living a life someone else intended for you. I did give some homework / classwork. Did y'all do this last week? I put this out for y'all. Anybody do this last week?
To be honest, I didn't do it because I know that I could tell you off the rip who I want, and I can tell you what it is that I already working on to this day. That I already have perfect, even though I perfected it already, but I'm still working on it.
Okay. What you got?
Okay, now, I'm very passionate about being an actor, mm-hmm. a comedian, and an artist.
Okay.
And, on my free days, right,
mm-hmm.
instead of me doing it, mm-hmm. I would be, like, on the camera, like, doing the comedy, acting a little bit,
mm-hmm.
and drawing. I'm still drawing in there, but... not as much. If I'm drawing something, I'll probably be drawing it for like family member or like for a clothing brand design, uh-huh. stuff like that. And that's my three talents. I'm multi talented, but that's one of my three strongest talents right now.
Okay.
I'm naturally good at it's a lot. So that's.
Well, no. So I guess my question is going to be, like, how. Because I think, what was it, the number three, I wanted you to start thinking of careers where you could basically bring together your talents and your passion. So, like, I feel like you kind of already had that. So, like, if you could give me, like, one or two things where you would be merging both something that you're good at with something that you're passionate about, what would that be?
I'll probably merge the acting with the comedy.
Okay.
I feel like that's the two things that really come together anyway, okay. Because you're a comedian, you got to learn how to act, or you got to learn how to put some jokes. Mm-hmm. Make it like a skit, so you make it like more like visual, so that people can understand what you're saying in your jokes.
Okay, fair enough. My guy, he was here last week, right?
Yeah.
Did you do this? Okay, give me something where I just ask him. What would be a way where you'd be merging both something that you're passionate about and something that you're talented in? Okay. My guy's in the front. Anything? No. So give me just for the sake of time, give me. I'm kind of skipping down from the first two, and more so just kind of going with number three of like, okay, if you could merge together something that you're both passionate with and something that you're talented in, like, what would be, you know what I mean?
Mostly, the biggest thing I like doing is getting active, and something I'm talented in
When you say get active, you just mean like being out about, just moving?
It's like, yeah, just physical activity in general. Uh-huh. I'm passionate about working out and getting other people fit. I like helping other people. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm very distinct with that.
Okay.
And I'm
No, I know you wasn't here last week, but just from looking at it, anything come to mind, like something that you'd be passionate at, or yeah, something that you're passionate about, and also something that you're talented in, how you can merge those into like a type of career, or type of, you know.
I'm not really passionate about anything like technical wise,
okay.
Career and skill wise. Okay. The one thing that I'm passionate about is like being the best at something. Like,
okay.
That's the one thing I always want to focus on. And it's okay. Like, no matter whatever that is,
mm-hmm.
Like, it could be skiing, it could be cooking,
mm-hmm.
or whatever life has in mind for me.
Mm-hmm. I understand. So, you got something to say?
Three things I'm passionate about. I'm passionate about healthy eating, like nutrition.
Okay.
Cooking.
Mm-hmm.
Making music.
Okay. Give me three things you're talented in.
I say cooking. Okay. A little bit talented making music.
Okay.
And third thing is, gotta go hard. Yeah.
I can dig that. All right. Let me go to the next slide. So when we were having a conversation last week, you got something, Jedi? Maybe slide over a little bit so I can't hear you from all the way over there. My bad. I didn't mean to uproot you, but go ahead. Okay. I got you. All right. Fair enough. So I want to move on to this. So last week when we were talking, I don't know if it was every person in the room, but I did kind of sense that some of you guys struggle with like self-confidence. Like, I don't know if that's a valid point. Oh, what you got? What? I got you.
Sorry,
it's all good.
One thing about them, right? They always will be right there chasing for you. Never chase them.
That way. Oh, man. Well, honestly, if you have enough confidence, you're right. They will chase you, basically. So, yeah, I don't know. How many of you guys, like, Wexy, let me ask you that. What year are you guys in here?
Like, I think this is our first year.
Sophomore.
Sophomore?
I'm
a sophomore. As well.
Sophomore? Okay.
First year.
How many of you guys would say, you know, being in a new environment, you guys felt the same way you felt, I guess, probably leaving your senior year? Like, the amount of confidence I would imagine you guys had going through the first 3 years, you have a certain amount of confidence of, you know, kind of knowing the system. How many of you guys would say that when you guys first came into this, you know, college, there was a little bit of self-doubt? Okay, fair enough. So let me see. I want to touch on this. What's up, Al? I want to touch on this. Actually, I'm gonna play a video. Let's see what time it is, and then I want to kind of just talk about it, talk through it a little bit.
I don't want to live. Stop just waking up. I lived in a abandoned building. I had no business living in the abandoned building. But E.T., your daddy wasn't in your life. Your mom was a teenage mother. You grew up, come on, E, look at your shirt. That's not an excuse. There is no excuse for not living up to your fullest potential. No excuse. I told you, I didn't get a new daddy. I didn't get a new mama. What changed? I changed. And I stopped being a victim. I stopped saying, I've got to wait for good things to happen to me. And I said, I'm going to rise. I'm going to fight. I'm going to work. I'm going to press forward. I'm going to learn. I'm going to do everything in my power. Every single day, I'm going to do everything in my power to become a victor, not a victim. Now, let me say this before I move forward. And I can't explain it, but you better feel me. Winners win, and losers lose. I can't explain it any better than that. I don't know how it happens, but winners win. And if you create a culture of losing, if you keep being a victim, if you keep letting losing happen to you, if you keep letting people do you and treat you any kind of way, it's going to become a culture. Let me tell y'all, I'm not from New Zealand, guys. Come on, listen to me very closely. I'm not from New Zealand, but I know about, let me say it this way so I can help you. I know about what team. I've never seen no black play a day in my life. I've never been to the stadium. Where's the stadium? Help me out, where's the stadium? Okay, I'm going to see right, you see what I did? I've never been to the stadium. We're like, Eric, the stadium? That's how I get that way, Eric. That's not the stadium. This way. I've never been there a day in my life. And if you watch some of my videos, I have all black in my videos. Why? Because they're what? They're winners. And when you're a winner, you don't even stay in your own little town. When you're a winner, winning spreads. So everybody, I got videos where I'm like, y'all, I don't really know how to show my passion. Somebody say, get your all blacks. I'm like, yep, that's what I need, all blacks.
So when you guys see this, what do you guys? Well, the video, with this, what comes to mind?
I know it's a little bit off topic, but
I was gonna say let's raise our hand too because he was talking first. Go, so Quan, go first, bro.
It's simple. Just stop bitching. Stop. Like,
no,
like,
you good?
I don't even like that. You like just stop bitching. Stop having excuses.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's just simple.
Burn.
This is a little bit off topic. When going through my head was the winners win. I can make that like out of a logo and like a merch. So I like, got that. But yeah. So, but what it spoke to me about is about something that I do most of the majority of the time. I have a lot of excuses instead of a lot of priority. So I gotta stop. Saying I can't do this and I can't do that. Like I said, I will do this and I will do that.
Mm-hmm.
So it gives you motivation to do what you want to do. Mm-hmm. Not to, later on to worry about it. So.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? She got it.
I would say what I got from the video is everybody's finish line looks different.
Mm-hmm.
So like, as long as you try, you're a winner.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't try, you're a loser. It's pretty much like black or white like that.
I'm gonna take it. You got anything? Mm-hmm.
Telling yourself that you can't do it,
Right. So I think I told you guys when I was here last week, like I didn't go to CCP. I went to Delaware County Community College. And I remember I had a professor who told me, I think he was a macroeconomics professor. And he basically said that the same stuff that he teaches like here at Delaware County was the same stuff he teaches at like Villanova, like an actual, you know, like a university, right? I don't know if you guys have ever dealt with this. When I was going to community college, there was almost like there was a feeling of like less than, like I'm going on a lesser route than maybe going straight to a 4-year degree, right? When I was asking, he's not in his classroom today, but it was a gentleman, kind of said something similar to what you said. Like he said that he couldn't do something, right? More times than not, winning and losing is more of a mindset than an actual thing, right? If I would have told you guys 15 years ago that I would be an author. I mean, I showed y'all 120, no, actually, deck. No, it's like 100 pages, something like that, right? I wouldn't have believed you. Like, if someone had told me, like, oh, in 15 years from now, you're going to be an author, you're going to be speaking at schools, you're going to be talking to students, helping them try to, you know, gain confidence. Like, I would have been like, nah, that's not going to be me. Right? But what changed? Give me some guesses or what you guys think might have changed. And I'll give you the backstory, but.
Motivation?
You walk in. What'd you say? Mindset?
Yeah, basically, yeah. You locked in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say, so let me take you guys back. So when I was in high school, I was the kid, I like to say I was the kid that was like too cool for like the smart kids, but also too corny for the popular kids.
Yeah, that was me.
So. Yeah, so like I never really fit in. I would try playing basketball. I used to lie. I mean, I thought I could shoot very well, yeah. Right? Sometimes when I speak, I say I can shoot like Steph. I can never shoot like Steph. Don't laugh that loud. Don't laugh that loud. Couldn't play defense, was overweight, had asthma. Basketball didn't work out. Baseball, I was playing baseball since I was 6 years old. Nice with baseball. I could hit, you know, pretty good at hitting. It's kind of same problem. Defense. Never found any time on the floor, on the field, right? Come on in. So, baseball was the same thing. I had a friend of mine who told me, this is when I was in my sophomore year of high school, I had a friend of mine who told me that he won scholarship money from a bowling tournament, right? And mind you, I'm still the same kid. I'm still the same kid that's struggling to fit in. I'm still the same kid that's, you know, my grades weren't that great, right? But I had opportunity. For some reason, I don't know why, even when I was that young, I've always wanted to go to college, but also understood that college costs money. So the idea that I could win scholarship money, and I knew I wasn't going to get it from anywhere else. I don't know if any of y'all, other parents said this to y'all, but my parents basically told me, like, you know, if you're going to go to school, it's kind of, it's up to you. It's not, we not just, this wasn't a reality where they just say, all right, here you go, you got it.
That's on you.
It's on me. So when I found this opportunity, I went all in. All in looked like, kind of like what E.T. was talking about, everyday grinding. Luckily for me, I lived maybe 6 minutes. Oh, no. A bowling alley was right down the street from me. And so I was able to practice a lot. But I would watch YouTube videos, reading books, like whatever I could do. If I go back to, I keep forgetting I got that clicker. If I go back to that quote, this is before I even knew it. But I was extremely intentional about how I went about it, right? I had a vision. I had a, I don't know if somebody said it, mindset, the goal may change. Yeah, like I got locked in. For some reason, I actually believed that I could be successful. Little did I know, through the work, I'm not gonna lie, it took a while. Probably took me maybe about a 4 or 5 year journey. Came a state champion. I think I told you guys last week, I've thrown 15 300s. For those who don't know, a 300 is a perfect game in bowling. Less than 1% of the world throws that, right? And then his book. If I'm being honest, the only difference between me as a bowler and me as an author was the goal, like, because my mindset had already shifted to say, okay, man, maybe if I've had success in this arena, and I know what it's like to not be at the top, right? Like, it's some people that are born with a quote-unquote silver spoon in their mouth, yeah, or they're born with success. Mm-hmm. That wasn't me, right? So seeing that journey of, oh, wow, like, if I actually be intentional, if I really worked hard at this, it's that simple. What you got?
Like,
No, I got you. So, go for it.
I wanted to ask you, did you have, like, when you locked in,
mm-hmm,
and you started moving up, mm-hmm, was you hard on yourself?
Extremely.
Did that get unhealthy for you?
It did.
How did you get out of it? I'm in the same situation.
So there's a means to everything, right? So I was at Newman yesterday, and I was telling them, I was saying that the idea that you're going to get someplace and that it's going to be like it, like, you know, let's say you graduate, right? There's like another thing. Once you get past that thing, it's another thing, right? So I would say what's helped me get past it is giving myself grace to rest. Like, if I'm being honest, like, the last couple of weeks have not been my quote-unquote best weeks of productivity, right? But I also, again, I still have the mindset of, all right, it is only I'm only a light switch away. Like, for me, that's why I really did want you guys to take this seriously, because really all that's about is just clarity. It's helping you guys get clear on, like, okay, what could I do, like, that will actually be fulfilling in my life, right? Because for those who weren't here, I used to drive for Uber too. So I drove for Uber for 6 years. And I think I drove somewhere between 25,000, 30,000 rides. In that 25,000 rides, like I said last week, 75% of them either hated what they did or barely liked what they did. Right? I don't think that's a great way to live. Right? But most people, if I'm being honest, I feel like, number one, struggle with clarity, but then number two, they struggle with that fourth thing, taking a shot on you. Because it is, it's scary. Let me be honest. In August, April of last year was when I decided that I was going to be a, you know, professional speaker. Like last year. Invested $4,000 into a course. I think in October, I invested like another $20,000. Like, being real, it was kind of scary. Even right now, sometimes it is. It still feels like I get back into that mode of like, man, like, I don't know if I can like really do this. Right. But then I go back. I think I have a friend of mine. He says, and this is not to say somebody's quote is wrong. I think everything depends. So even your question about like, how do you get out of that, like going hard all the time? It's a balance. And you got to learn the balance for you. There is no necessarily right answer. Like, even in my book, I talk about, like, I don't know if you guys ever seen someone bowling, but they finish like this. They got, like, the leg over here, the arm over here, yeah, right? That's, like, a form of balance. It's, like, they have a foundation, right? I wish I can tell you that there was a perfect balance to life, right? What's up, man? It's not. Everybody's life is different because everybody's goals are different. Everybody's experiences are different. Everybody's environments are different, right? I can't judge anybody because I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't know what you're like, what's in front of you, right? So to answer your question, I would say I don't know if it's going to resonate with you the way it resonated with me. When I heard it, my therapist said just a little bit better each day, right? I'm going to keep it a buck with you. I hated it. I was like, a little bit? Bro, you know who I am? Like, I don't do just a little bit better. Like, it's got to be, you know, exponentially better.
Yeah.
Right?
I feel you with it. Cause like, did you feel like you couldn't find, like, you couldn't give yourself props for something little? It had to be something big. Like, every time I do something little that I should give myself props for,
mm-hmm.
it's like, I can't. Like, I try to force myself to say, oh, yeah, you did a good job. Like, good mm-hmm. shit. But it's like, me physically, like, I just can't give myself props for that shit unless I do something big.
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying?
So it's nah, bro, I'm gonna be honest with you. I think last week, again, wasn't one of my most productive weeks. I gave myself credit for going to take a shower. just keep it 100. Yeah, nah. You gotta extend grace to yourself. And yeah, it is tough when you're brought up, like, again, your environment. For some reason, you were conditioned to make yourself have to always work hard, right? That was part of your environment. That was for a season. That's not every single day, because that's unrealistic. Like, even when I talk about being intentional, I think, because someone even asked me this last week, they were saying, you know, like, that mean I gotta, like, it's gotta be like every day, like I gotta just be like on it. And it's like, it's unrealistic. The idea is that when you're intentional, you understand that, okay, I'm not perfect. I need to also intentionally give myself grace, right? Because you're not every day is not going to be blissful. Sometimes it is. You're going to be dealt with a hand that, to be honest, you couldn't see. Like right now, yesterday, I have a 100-year-old grandmother, right? 100, well, great-grandmother. My dad passed away when I was 21. His parents passed away probably 5 or 6, maybe like 7, 8 years before that. So, and then his sister, my aunt, wants nothing to do with my great-grandmother. My mom lives in North Carolina. My brother's not married, but he's got his own family, you know, in New Jersey. Like, I didn't plan on having that type of responsibility, right? And to be honest, yesterday I was struggling, because I took her to the eye doctor, and she said, the doctor said that he gave me almost like a list of things she got to do, because she had to get almost like she had a stroke in her eye maybe like about a year and a half ago. And they wanted to do like an injection, but I guess because she had like some type of mucus on her eye, it's like, so yeah, so I'm gonna give you these wipes. She has to clean it. Then it was some weird thing. She said, it was like, they said, he wanted her to get like a sock, put some rice in it, put it in the microwave, put it over her eye. And in my head, I'm just like, bro, she lived by herself. Like, she's not gonna be able to do all these things. And in my head, I'm just like, dang, dude, does that now mean I have to, you know, step up that much more and take care of her? Right? Like, I didn't expect those things to happen. And in the moment, yeah, like, it almost crushed me. Like, yesterday, around this time yesterday, I was severely overwhelmed. I reached out to a couple of friends that I have, said, bro, I need some prayer. I reached out to my therapist. He's always said to me, I can call him anytime. If I'm being honest, sometimes I try to do things on my own so much that I almost go away from, you know, the help that I have. But I was like, bro, like, I need it, right? Again, intentional. Don't suffer in silence. That's actually what we're going to talk about next week, is asking for help. But, no, I totally get it. Let me ask you guys this. No, absolutely. Going back to that concept, winners win, losers lose. What if you were just one win away from being a winner? I'll go for it.
I was gonna ask, it's not like everything is that black and white. I feel like winners are losers at times because they might cheat or stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, losers can't.
Hold on for 1 second, because your hand is doing something to me. What's up?
I'm sorry. Fellas, gentlemen, manners in the house. When somebody's giving a presentation, we do not cut in front of them. We walk around the room, even if it's the long way, to get to the other side. It's very rude and disrespectful to the presenter. Okay? I know nobody's doing it on purpose, but we just have to keep letting you know.
Yes.
I just want to make the announcement once, because the team keeps having to make the announcement. Alright? And you're blocking the camera. Thank you.
It's all good.
Like I was saying, not everything is black and white, so I do feel like people might see this and think, oh, well, since I lost a lot of weight, even if you did lose, probably improved on something. I feel like that's winning, so it's not just as black and white as it seems.
Well, so you might have stepped out. So I was saying earlier, winning and losing is more of a mindset than it is like an occurrence or like a person, right? I think oftentimes we do get into that place where we say to ourselves, like, you know, I failed this, I did this, my family's like this. That means that my life can only be this, right? So before you, might have been right before you came in, but I was talking about, I don't even know if I was saying how in high school, like I wasn't this person, right? Because this week we were basically talking about confidence, because I heard that was like something, you know, very, very, I heard a lot of people kind of allude to that last week, right? So the idea is, right, is how do we shift that mindset? Like I was telling you guys, for me, because some days I do actually feel like a loser. Like, just keeping it a buck. Like, there are definitely some days, some moments, where I feel like, bro, I just can't figure this thing out. Like, I done did this, I done did that. Why is this not working? Right? And what I was going to say was, I have a friend of mine's where he says, I'm probably going to mess up the quote, but more or less he says, yesterday's effort wasn't, is that mine? Or somebody, oh, that's him. Somebody. It's all right. But no, now I'm trying to think, what was I saying? What was I saying? Somebody remind me. Anybody, who was paying attention? Tell me something. What the heck was I saying? Back in high school, all right. Thank you. He would say something to the degree of yesterday's effort is not good enough for today, or yesterday's success is not good enough for today. I understand the sentiment and I understand what he's saying. At the same time, I'm a person that reminds myself of what I done yesterday to remind myself that I can do what was needed for today. Does that make sense? Because oftentimes, like you were saying, sometimes we beat ourselves up almost. Be like, you know, I got to do this, I got to do that. And it's like, bro, what if the only thing changed from yesterday to today is the thing that's in front of me? Like, I'm still the same person, right? So if I accomplish whatever I accomplished yesterday, that then gives me, for me personally, I use that to give me the faith that, okay, I can do this now later. So what you got?
Basically, for if you pass a semester, say you pass the fall semester, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have some struggles,
mm-hmm.
but you got past the fall semester.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're in the spring semester.
Mm-hmm.
So what you do is you're using the fact that you passed, you might have struggled through it, but you
mm-hmm.
passed.
Mm-hmm.
You're using that kind of as that motivation, as mm-hmm. strength for.
Mm-hmm. If I'm being honest, I was, I don't know if you were in there, I was talking about my success I had with bowling. That was when I was 20 years old. I'm now 30. In a way, I still reference back to that, because it was a 4 or 5 year journey where it was just me practicing, working at it. And I saw, like, oh wow, like, man, I sucked at one point, and now people know me now. You know what I mean? So it's just like, all right. So like that, the next period of my life was from, I would say 21, 22. I got into my first, it was called multi-level marketing. It was a business, right? And I remember kind of just having that idea of like, okay, I'm starting off at the bottom. They have training and information for me. Let me just do this and let me just try it out. Let me see how far I can go. I think it was a million dollar company. And I got within, I think, not to... The number sounds better than what it was, but I got into like the 10% of the company, like just from doing the work. Most people, they think that because it's a new environment that they're not enough for that environment. So that's why I asked you guys, like, how many of you guys struggle with that when you guys first came from high school to college? Like that idea of like, oh, maybe I'm not good enough. Maybe this is a new environment. You know what I mean? Like, you might have changed some behaviors. But I guess what I'm trying to impart on you guys is a winning culture is just that. It's just a culture. It's a mindset. It's really just something. It's something that you can carry with you. Like, one of the things I talk about a lot just in conversation. I love defense in sports because defense travels, right? Most times, if you have like a really high octane offense, and think about it, any sport, right? In football, let's say you got a really, really good football offense. More times than not, it's usually because it's throwing the ball, right? What happens when the weather's cold, freezing? It's a little harder to catch the ball. It's a little harder to grip the ball, right? Defense more so is just effort, schemes, a strategy, right? It's not to say that you shouldn't have a good offense, right? But if you have, an elite defense, that defense can travel with you. A lot of times, I'll get to you, a lot of times your mindset, or I'll say for myself, a lot of times my mindset is my defense. That's my foundation. If I'm being honest, even when I wrote the book, I don't know if I mentioned this last week, but I gave a ride to a lady in my Uber. This is before I was a quote-unquote motivational speaker, right? But she was telling me how she wanted to write a book. And I, you know, gave her my motivational speech. I was just like, you know, hey, this is a guy named Les Brown. He's a motivational speaker. Now, he actually made money with it, all that good stuff. And he had this quote. He said, the richest place, the wealthiest place in the world is a graveyard. Because that's where people's dreams and goals that they never pursue go. I said it to her, and I was like, that's nice. You know what I mean? I felt good about myself. I was like, yeah, I just did a good service. I just, you know, helped this person. But then I felt like a hypocrite. Because I did have the idea for the book, but I hadn't started it yet. She was actually already started. And she was like, nah, I can't do this. You know, I'm working. It'll never be successful. And I'm just like, you kind of counting yourself out before you even get started. Yeah.
That as well. I feel like that's what it is. A lot of people, like, we could give great advice, but we can't give ourselves great advice, and I don't know why that is. Like, me, myself, I do that. Like, I tend to give good advice, and then I think about it. I'm like, man, why I ain't tell myself that?
What you got? No, oftentimes it is tougher to follow your own advice because that requires you to look in the mirror at yourself and say, like, why am I not doing this? Right? Like, and if it's one thing that I want you guys to really, I guess, maybe start if you don't do it already, is journaling. Journaling for me has been like transformative because it's allowed me to see the days where I am quote unquote winning and the days where I'm quote unquote losing. And then I can look back and say, oh, I did this different that day, or I did this different. A lot of times we just go through life and it's almost as if we think life is happening to us. What you got?
Mm-hmm. What's a good strategy in terms of utilizing journalism, journaling, that offer you with some offer good reflection? Excuse me, talk about my mouth. But I found when I journal, I rarely go back to review what I actually wrote in the past.
So I would say it's two part. So one, having a system of reflection. So for me, every Sunday, I would basically go back throughout the week and just kind of read through. And that's the other thing too. So for my personal journaling, I only journal for a minute and a half and then I just turn it off. Because my other thing for me is that I want something that could be repeatable, consistent. Oftentimes I feel like for me personally, I don't know if it's just because I've grown up in a generation, I got TikTok brain, but it's really hard for me to focus for more than maybe 3 or 4 minutes at a time. It's just tough. So, you know, I would intentionally set my bar low so that way, even if I did feel like going more, then that'll be a day where I felt like doing more. Right. But it would just be a minute and a half. And then on Sunday, it would be all right, maybe like 3 or 4 minutes. And I'm going to keep it about with you guys. I actually did fall off from journaling. And you were saying that you rarely check what you journal. At least you have it written down. Right? Like there's always something that you can go back to. Like, even for myself, I used to write poetry, and I remember writing this poem after my dad passed away. Man, I was so angry. Like, there was, like, a lot of anger. I didn't read it for maybe, like, a year or two later. But when I read it, I was like, oh, wow. Hey, bro, like, I can really see the difference in, like, who we are today versus, like, who we were in that moment. And it kind of goes back to my point of I'm okay. Like, I know some people kind of, I don't know if you guys ever heard the quote, what have you done for me lately? That type of mindset, like, you know what I mean? It's almost like you're always trying to prove yourself to somebody. I'm going to be honest, that could be very tiring. And it's, I don't think I have the slide on this one. I think I had it last week. I didn't get a chance to go to it. But I think a lot of us become human doers. But really, we're human beings. Like, if I always had to do something to get approval, I'll be honest, that's probably was the most transformative or one of the best things I heard somebody told me last year. I was going through it, depressed, anxious, all that stuff. It's my Bible study group. And they were like, bro, just come. Like, we don't need you to be Superman. Just be you. A lot of us, I would suggest you have people in your corner where you can just be. Because a lot of times we don't have those people around us because we are. A lot of us are doers. A lot of us, we know what it's like to do, right? You got something?
Yeah, I'm going to backtrack a little bit.
Go for it.
My brother Carl over there talked about journaling,
mm-hmm.
and he used the word reflection.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we kind of gloss over that a lot with a minimal amount of concern. But being in an academic environment, you're going to be called upon to write reflection papers for what happened the whole semester, what you learned.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, we do this in our minds, subconsciously, knowingly or unknowingly, we do this all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But anybody who knows me, most of my students will always, they will tell you, every time they see me, I'm always emphasizing the point of writing things down, mm-hmm. writing down how your day went, even mm-hmm. the most seemingly insignificant thing.
Mm-hmm.
Writing that down, how your day started, the middle part, the end. The same way you take notes in class, hopefully, right?
He said hopefully.
A strategic plan for your life, like this college has a strategic plan for its longevity and mm-hmm. long-term existence, mm-hmm. long-term sustainability. You should look at yourself in a similar way.
Mm-hmm.
You should look at yourself. We should look at ourselves. I'm going to include myself in that.
Mm-hmm.
We should look at ourselves in a similar way. Right, because the ability to reflect on, like the brother Brian said, what happened to me last week, if I could reflect back to a similar circumstance that happened to me last week, last month, last semester,
mm-hmm.
then maybe I can adjust
mm-hmm.
to whatever's going on in front of me at this particular point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would tell you, I got all types of little pads and notebooks and binders and bits mm-hmm. and pieces of everything that goes on with my life, with my students, what goes on in my personal life, business, mm-hmm. personal, friendship, whatever it might be. They all can come together and tell a story, and the mm-hmm. power is in your story.
Yep.
That's all I want to share.
And I appreciate that. As a matter of fact, just today I decided to journal, and I was thinking, because again, I can be very frank with you guys. Like I said, I've invested quite a bit of money in the last year, right? To the point where sometimes it is overwhelming to think, oh my gosh, like I gotta figure all this stuff out. And then I thought, as I was journaling, I felt like a thought came to mind. I was like, bro, you was pretty much broke when you was in college. Like, so my trajectory was from community college, then I went to Temple. Was at Temple for a year and a half. My dad passed away, took a year and a half off from school, and then wound up going to a school in Chicago. At the time, I was also very, you know, entrepreneurial and trying to put myself out there, but I didn't understand debt very well. I'm just gonna say at that moment, I did not understand that you had to pay back what you borrowed, right? So I just remember one day looking at my bank account, and I was like, wow, like I done maxed out all these credit cards. And I was like, dang. And it was same feeling, overwhelmed. Like, man, how am I going to do this? I just remember looking, I think it was Thanksgiving. just to continue to paint the picture, I remember I couldn't even, I think I wanted to get something from Dunkin' Donuts. It was only like $6, and that thing got declined. I was like, dang. But I think I had maybe like $1,500 in my PayPal credit account. And I wound up investing in, it was like almost like a course of some sort. It was called Insane Productivity. It was to help you to be more productive and things of that nature. I still made an investment in myself. Actually, I want you guys to catch that. I still made an investment in myself even when it might have not made as much sense. I'm not saying to not be a good steward of your money, but I also want you guys to not, when you're investing in yourself, that's always the best investment that you can make. Does that make sense? Right, so I made this investment. I remember actually, there was a Panera Bread right below my dorm. They didn't hire me. I was applying for another one. While I was waiting, I actually went to go volunteer. I think that next week I got a job at the Panera Bread. I remember in the interview, the lady said, she wrote down a number. The interview went that well. She was like, this is how much we could pay you. Now, mind you, in Philly, I don't know what the minimum wage tax is now, but at the time it was like $7.50. Maybe like, I think the most I made at that time was probably $8 an hour. And she wrote down like $13. I was like, I'll start today. Like as a cashier, right? That was in 2018. We get into the pandemic, you know, I graduate, pandemic comes in 2020, 2021. Now I've been doing Uber for that time. I wound up paying, I was in over $15,000 worth of credit card debt. By November of 2021, I had paid it off.
From Uber.
I'm not going to lie, them stimulus checks helped too. They did help. Yeah, them $1,200, but if I go back, I was intentional. I was budgeting. At the same time, I don't want to say I never lost confidence in myself, but I reminded myself of like, bro, like just take it one day at a time. Because at the time it was extremely overwhelming. Like, I don't know if any of y'all are in $15,000 worth of credit card debt. It's a little, you know what I'm saying? Without having necessarily a steady income coming in at the time.
I have a question about that.
Go for it. It's a good question. It's kind of hard to take me all the way back there. I would say, to be honest, kind of what I'm talking about right now. So that reflection period, right? Having other people to reflect for you too, like to pour into you. Like I was talking to a friend of mine, he's a pastor, he's a speaker. And I said to him, I was like, you know, how do you, because we've talked before, he said that he's admitted that he gets depressed sometimes after preaching or speaking sometimes. This may sound weird, but sometimes when you feed your ego, there's also kind of like a, what goes up must also come down. I'll just say it that way. So I can get really high. I can feel really good. Like if you guys come up to me like, man, Brian, that was so good. That was, oh man, that really resonated with me. Like, that can sometimes, I can get really high, and then when things aren't going as well, or if I don't have that same dopamine rush because it's external, right, then I can get really low. So I asked him, I said, bro, how do you not do that? He was like, well, you don't necessarily get depressed, but you just learn how to deal with it. What he said was, is have people around you that their only goal is to build you up, right? So, to your question of like how did I get through that time period, I was still surrounded with people that would continue to build me up. And I did, bro. Like, so it's ironic that my logo is what it is, one shot at a time. Because oftentimes people think that in a game of bowling you can throw 300 from the first frame. Like there's 10 frames, you gotta throw a strike every single frame. So every frame takes focus, takes, you know, that calmness, that deep breath, right? Oftentimes, as we get older, we almost become jaded a little bit because things don't turn around as fast as we would probably like them to. right? That's why I have this picture here of, it says, what do you fear? But I always talk about this baby here. Al, you got kids?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
How many kids you got?
Three girls?
I mean, I don't know if that's true, but would you say that a baby falls quite a bit when they're trying to learn how to walk?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
But for some reason, they just keep getting back up.
Mm-hmm. And the premise is you keep on going, right? You fall, mm-hmm. but you keep on going. So we walk. We like experts at walking.
Mm-hmm.
But we weren't when we were a baby, right? We sucked at it. We were terrible.
Mm-hmm.
And me and Bernard just talked about, you fall down. Keep getting back up, mm-hmm. right? Because if we didn't, then we might be crawling around out here on the sidewalk. But we got up, and now we walk. Experts, and I just wanted to Ryan's question. It's a variety, and I think it depends on the person,
mm-hmm.
as far as what you do. So for when I have challenges, and again, I don't care who you are, what your title is, you're gonna have challenges in life. It's just life.
Yep.
You're gonna have stress. You're gonna get knocked down. You gotta get back up. So I had to build tools, right? Like a toolbox, a toolkit, right?
Mm-hmm.
I had to build these tools for various situations. So if I feel myself either with imposter syndrome, when I go somewhere, I'm not feeling the most confident, right?
Mm-hmm.
I start saying my affirmations, right? Those positive affirmations, like, come on, Al, you've done it before.
Mm-hmm.
You know you can do it. You know you're prepared, good enough for this,
mm-hmm.
right? And you might still be a little nervous with that natural nervousness, but it doesn't stop you from performing and doing what you need to do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, also, it's just like Brian said, looking back on past successes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, man, I did some things already.
Mm-hmm.
How did I get to this point in my life, right?
Mm-hmm.
To be a college student. So you kind of look back and reflect on those past things that you did to help you power forward. Like, almost like, let me snap back to myself, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because we have those two wolves, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you got that negative one and that positive one, right?
Mm-hmm.
So make sure that positive one is more fed than that negative.
I like what you said, fed. Yeah. Because you got to feed your mind. You got to feed that. In a way, it almost is like we have like two versions of ourselves in ourselves almost. Like we have ourselves that actually wants us to be successful, and we got ourselves that, you know, kind of is always trying to be comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday I said to the student, I said, wear your jeans more than your sweatpants.
What you mean by that?
So when you wear jeans, your jeans tell you exactly where you are. When you wear sweatpants, they kind of you could just be kind of lying to yourself. So, but a lot of people, you know, they like to wear sweatpants because it makes them feel comfortable. Do you know what I'm saying? I came up with that yesterday. Literally, because I put on these jeans yesterday, and I was like, dang, bro, you gonna put on some weight. You know what I mean? No, but in all seriousness, like, sometimes we have to get out of the comfort. That's why I have here, what do you fear? Because as a baby, you didn't fear anything. Somewhere along the line, you know, somebody taught you to be fearful. And don't get me wrong, there are some things that, you know, I wouldn't say just walk in the middle of the street as a car is literally coming down at you, right? Use wisdom, use common sense, use discernment, ask mentors. But what are you fearing that you know that you, like, you're just like, bro, why am I afraid of this?
Because a lot of people die from it?
No, not. I'm saying,
the most rational thing I would never want to do is it does something to my body.
Mm-hmm.
It makes my heart go like crazy jumpy,
mm-hmm.
and mess the thing with my whole nervous system, my body, and my shit shaky.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I was like heights. And plus, I've always been like that when I was a little kid.
I don't know. Were you here last week when I was talking about the zip line? So I was in Vegas, and there was a zip line. And basically, I remember reading on the thing, because I'm not like the biggest fan of heights. It doesn't do what you're saying to me, but it does give me a little, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I remember reading on the thing, it said, you could die. And I was like, dang, I don't want to do this no more. But I said there, you know, I don't know if y'all 21, but I got some liquid courage.
I'm 22.
All right, so you can get some liquid courage, you know, liquid courage if you want, you know what I mean? I wouldn't advise it.
You're late for that, brother.
No. In all seriousness, I was like, all right, now I want to try this. Get up there. And mind you, I was kind of terrified still. But I did it. And I was telling you guys last week, I came back like on a zip line, and the guy there, he was like, "Oh, you didn't get like any videos or photos." I was like, "Oh no, I didn't even know I could do that." So when I went on there the second time, I was middle fingers, I was dabbing. This is like 10 years ago. Like, dabbing was still cool. But the only thing that changed was that I experienced it, and I realized I did not die. That was like, a lot of times our fears, I don't know the exact acronym. False evidence appearing real. Oftentimes our fears are we think that something could happen. Actually, I'll tell you guys one more story. This really just happened. I was on my way to Dallas, and the lady next to me, I was supposed to have the middle seat. And I was supposed to sit in the middle seat. As I'm coming down my aisle, I'm like, the lady's sitting in the middle seat. And I'm like, and there was somebody already sitting in the, you know, on the window. So I'm like, well, I guess I'll sit in the aisle. I'm not going to lie, I was kind of happy that I wasn't going to sit in the middle. But I asked her, I was like, why are you sitting in the middle? Or like, why would you want to switch seats and all that good stuff? And she was like, you really want to know? And I was like, yeah, tell me. And she was like, well, I used to have anxiety about flying. So basically, she did all the research she could possibly do. Again, intentional. Because oftentimes we have fears, but we don't actually face them. She was like, look, I gotta get to these places, so I'm gonna, you know, let me see if I can figure this thing out. So in her research, she found that basically, I felt bad for the person now, but basically she said that the person sitting in the window seat has the most likelihood, like if like a crack happens in the window or something like that, they can get like sucked out. Yeah. And I was like, dang, that's messed up, because I'm sure you did not tell that to the lady that you switched seats with. Right, but it was what. But she did what she did, you know, to help her in that moment. Yeah. Right, but she was saying, because even as I think I had some questions about like the flight and stuff like that, and she would like tell, oh yeah, well no, that's not the person, and no, they don't do this. And I was like, dad, you really done like really study this thing, yeah. Right? If I'm being honest, take this back to my own personal life. If I'm being honest. My leap of becoming a professional speaker and the amount of money that I've invested in it is more so just to see, like, can I actually do this or not?
Yeah. So it was never like to get paid?
No, I still want to get paid. But no, but what I'm saying is this is why I asked, what do you fear? Because a lot of us, like, I was very comfortable, like, driving for Uber. Yeah. I don't know if y'all know. I mean, because some people, I had this one girlfriend, she thought that Uber drivers made, like, $4 an hour. And I'm like, no, like, I was making, like, $30 an hour. And had a flexible schedule, got to meet people. I was basically giving motivational speeches in there. I was pretty cool with that. If I'm being, I mean, I could have. If I'm being honest, I would say it was 70% fulfilling. Because it was. I did feel good about it, right? But I was like, man, is it possible to get to 85? Like, is it possible to get to 100? So if it's possible, why not give it a shot? Now, mind you, I wanna say this, especially since we got this baby up here on this screen. The fact that I don't have as many responsibilities allows me to take some of those risks. Because if I did have maybe a family to support and things like that, maybe I wouldn't take such a risk in that way, right? So that's the other part of that is, are you positioning yourself right now to be able to take some risks when you're a little bit older, right? Even honestly, even the amount of money that I've invested, part of the reason I've been able to invest as the amount of money that I have into the speaking thing is because I paid off that $15,000 worth of credit card debt. Like I was stewarding my time and my money back then. I didn't know 3 years later I would have this opportunity to jump into speaking, right? So, let me see what time it is. That's 3:08. So technically we do gotta wrap up. What questions do you guys have before I...
You're gonna be here every Tuesday.
Next Wednesday.
Every Wednesday.
I don't know, Al, can I be here every Wednesday? Can we make that happen? I can use a little steady paycheck. That'd be nice. tell them the students want it. They want it. I heard them. Can I get a petition going? Yes, sir. What you got?
The one thing I wanted to piggyback off of about when you had a slide about
Me personally, everybody's mindset is different, but I fear almost everything. It's like speaking to people, going outside, I always think something might happen, but it's like that pretty much the motivation for me to overcome. Because like, for an example, there's been times where I'm relaxed and I'm calm, and I feel like something's wrong. It's like, there should never be a moment where you're a product of your environment and you're trying to grow to become something better and you're comfortable where you're at. There's always room for improvement. There's always room to be better. And it's like, when you have that motivation, you have that energy, it's like people just attract towards it.
You clap up for him. I wanna just like I was telling Quan, I wanna give you grace to also to rest too. Cause everything is not a marathon. Everything is not I gotta just be on every single day. So I wanna give you that grace. How old are you right now? Not you. How old are you? 24. 24? That's how old I was when I graduated. So because I'm learning this now at 30, right? But I want to give you permission to like give yourself grace too. Because oftentimes when you do have that mindset of like, I'm going to conquer everything. A lot of times we don't actually give ourselves that ability to also rest too when we need to. Sometimes we wait till it's too late and we get burnt out. You know what I'm saying? So I'm with you because I've been there. You said sometimes you have a fear. I think you said talking to people or something like that. I remember when I first got into it's called network marketing, my first business. And so you have what's called warm market, which are people that you already know, and you have cold market, which are people you have never met before. And I remember that I was like, man, it might just be possible. Let me just see. People tell you can just talk to cold market people that you don't know and see what happens. I remember I was at a gas station. And, I'm just like, let me just give it a shot. Just try it. And I'm getting gas, and I see the guy next to me. I was like, hey, nice car. I, turned around. I was like, all right, that was good. Good job, Brian. Good job. All right. But then he said to me, he was like, oh, yeah, so I got it back. I was like, oh, snap, you having a conversation. All right, I'm ready. I study, coach. I study, right? But just putting myself out there, showed me like, oh wow, like maybe everybody isn't as scary as I thought, or like I can have conversations with people. If I'm being, the only reason I have this opportunity is because I was shadowing somebody else and I talked to them. so do it. What you got? And remind me your name too one more time. Remind me your name.
Oh, Marcel.
Marcel, talk to me, Marcel. What you got?
I find it that like almost everybody is like they're always like you kind of witness different things about different people. Like maybe like somebody wearing a certain face, but like they just a chill person like approach. Like myself, I don't find myself like talking much unless I'm like spoken to. But I feel like I can hold a conversation pretty well. Like I can talk to anybody you're of.
No, so it's just about understanding. So for me, I would get this book. It's called Skill with People. It's like a super quick read. But I said it last week. My goal, even in these conversations, is to be more interested, to be interesting. Like I want to be able to give you guys something that you guys can actually use, not just tell you guys about myself, right? So I practice that in Uber. Like as an Uber driver, I would practice on people. At first, I would get into trouble where like I would ask them too many questions, and I had people like report me. They'd be like, I felt like I was in an interview, and I was like, Dad, that wasn't what I was trying to do, right? But then I would adjust, so I would be like, all right, I need to be more aware, so I would ask a question. I'd be like, oh, what's new with you? How you doing today, bro?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing good. What you got going on for today?
Chilling, going baby mama house.
All right. I ain't got nothing else. I probably was just in the conversation, right? Like when I was in Uber, I'll be like, all right, you got any preference in music? Like if I didn't know how to keep the conversation going or something like that, or they didn't give me an opportunity. Like if some people, I would say, oh, how you doing today? They'd be like, fine. And I'm like, oh, all right, they probably don't really want to talk.
Yeah.
Right?
You got to read the room.
Yeah, you just got to read the room. But practice. That's really all it is. It's practice. I want you guys to think of life as like a practice. Like, you don't have to get it right. I think this was, yeah, this slide here. Are you willing to fail forward? A lot of us sometimes are afraid, so afraid to fail that we just don't do anything. And it's like, bro, literally as the baby is like getting up, he's still going forward. I don't ever see a baby trying to learn how to walk going this way. Like it don't usually work that way. Usually they get up and they're going this way, right? They still fall, but they're failing forward, right? So don't be afraid to fail. You get up, be all right. What's the worst that could happen? Honestly.
Oh, I can get back up.
The world blew up, bro.
No, what? Good, you don't got to worry about feeling. We all dying.
Man. Yeah. So, let me see. Yeah, that's my last slide. I will be back next week to end it out, unless you guys start that petition. You know what I'm saying? Help your boy get here more often. But yeah, I think that's it for today. No problem. Absolutely.